If you're looking for final round coverage of the 2015 European Open, you found SpinTV, you found me. I'm Jamie Thomas, and I'm joined today by Paul McBeth, the man who needs absolutely no introduction. Paul, how's it going this morning?
It's going well. I'm feeling good. Sore, but good.
All right, Paul's going to break down what was going on inside his mind. He's going to have a little insight onto the course, the round, and everything in between. If you're ready, we're ready. Let's get it started. Starting this round, Paul is 26 under par. Will and Ricky are tied at 23 under par, and KJ Nybo is sitting just behind them, hoping to catch up and make up some ground as we go to hole one. A very formidable starting hole with a big triple mando, the two giant lion logos staring at you in the face, forcing you to make a great throw with the gallery watching. How much pressure is this hole, just to put it pinpoint to the pin?
Oh, this is a huge hole. Like you said, the triple mando. And then it's a shorter hole, so it's really a touch shot. And then with a little bit of downhill, it's really hard to get your disc to stop on that green.
13 feet of downhill change is 4 meters. It's only about 302 feet, so easily reachable for all these guys. A basic right-handed hyzer, and you can see Ricky's going to kick the tree right there, and Will Schusterick will be up. These guys are always in this final group with you, it seems. You see a lot of the familiar faces, you know, hunting this title. What's it like to play with these guys, you know, day in and day out?
It's great. I mean, I know at least one of the two, if not both, or sorry, all three, they're going to bring their game, especially in final rounds. You know, they want to put the pressure on whoever the leader is. And then having KJ here is, you know, it's awesome to come out here in, you know, his home country, or sorry, not country, but in Europe. And it's exciting to play and have that pressure, you know, put on all of us.
And you see, Will kicked a tree a little bit early. He had a very similar shot in an earlier round, and he makes a correction that he was unable to accomplish in the earlier round, where he's able to lay it up and get a little bit of a better putt. Last time he went down the hill, like you're saying, it's a very fast green going downhill, and you really want to start off with a birdie at this course.
Yeah, this is one of the easier par threes on the course, but with it being the first hole and all those nerves, they kind of get to some players, and I unfortunately rolled down that little hill right there and could not put the putt in.
A little bit of a spit out and a little practice in the lineup, but you got to say, don't worry, you do have a couple strokes lead, and I have to ask you, we talked about this on the show last night, and we've talked about it before, but how is your back feeling at this point in the round?
I think there was so much adrenaline pumping. I didn't feel it necessarily at the beginning. It was more the follow-throughs of the shot, but that straddle putt there was not a comfortable position.
You can see that it obviously is so crucial when you have, you know, part of your core is unable to engage the way you normally do, especially going into a major nonetheless, that you really have to make the adjustment. Lining up a big sidearm, a hole you called an ace on a couple days prior, but somebody else was able to ace it. And what was your strategy going in here to try to correct? You found the out of bounds to the right before.
Yeah, I know this is a really fast fairway and green, so I just needed to hang it out to the left but still not have a large skip, like you said, that will go out of bounds. And unfortunately, I threw it a little too tight. It might have been good that it hit that tree, it might not have, but you know, I stayed in bounds. And Ricky right there hit the same tree, and Will throwing this backhand. I don't know how players can get this shot with confidence, but you know, Will does it right here.
Will does have a great sort of that hyzer flip to turn over backhand, really touch, turning it over, and great shot there. And KJ Nybo, who has just been a monster on this hole, all over it.
Yeah, this roller, I don't know what disc he throws here, but it seems to go right at the pin every time. I know he didn't really like this line as soon as he let it go, but the consistency of his roller, it gets pretty close nearly every time.
And a little shorter, a little, you were inbounds this time, trying to make a similar run to the shot you had in the President's Cup where you threw it in for three. A fantastic shot on that day. And Ricky lining up the long gun.
Yeah, when Ricky has a putt like that, you never know. he probably makes those 50% of the time, so I almost thought I lost a stroke when I missed my putt.
And that's a rare, you know, a very rare compliment. You can't give that to too many people, saying that you're going to think you're losing a putt when he's at least 60 feet outside the, or at least 60 feet from the pin.
Yeah, Will's backhand right there got inside the circle, but he had that bush in his way and kind of obstructed his view of the basket.
And then Ricky tapped. Well, he's able to put it in for the three, and Paul for his three as well. Center cut, very solid, and KJ for par.
Yeah, these first two holes are holes you want birdies on. I mean, if you start out with twos on both of them, you're feeling really good going into those next few wooded holes, but unfortunately, nobody in our group birdied either one.
Slow start for the lead card, and it's kind of been, that was the tail of the tape this whole weekend. You know, lead card did not really start out super fast most of the rounds on those first two holes, despite the fact that you really need to get a jump and take advantage of any birdies that you can out here. Hole three goes down on the other side of a road, down in an arboretum. So you'll see a little more of a wooded and technical side of the beast coming up through hole seven here, or hole three through seven, excuse me. And lining up another sidearm.
Yeah, this hole is one where you want to end up, you know, getting up to the right, kind of opens up the fairway for your second shot. If you end up down on the left there, there's multiple trees that just obstruct, you know, your line to the basket, and it's either a roller or a sidearm, or, you know, like a longer turnover, but you want to end up right in the fairway, and these rollers that these guys throw are pretty risky, but they get them way down the fairway.
And Ricky, who, I don't know, do you see Ricky throw a lot of rollers? It's not a common shot that I see from him. And he, you know, clipped the tree early, and he's going to have a pretty good recovery shot from there.
Yeah, I saw Ricky throw this hole twice, and he threw rollers both times, but they're both different discs. I don't know what the adjustment he made was, or, you know, it didn't seem like it worked out. But, I mean, you never know with Ricky. He could put this one under the basket here, or he can, you know, go on the road.
Always a threat. He is going to go wide over the road, and he had a gap, took advantage of it. Throw the hyzer when you can. Easiest shot in the game. Will Schusterick lining up his forehand.
Oh, caught an early tree right there.
Caught definitely an early tree. Will off to a little bit of a slower start. You can see he's trying to press early. He has an aggressive mentality through these first few holes. And
yeah, this was kind of a downhill sidearm for me, which is really difficult. I don't have that confidence in getting the disc to go left and then finish right, but fortunately it caught that bush and kicked out a little bit.
And KJ with the sidearm from the partial straddle, at least. He's going to turn it over a little bit too much. He's going to end up left of the pin. We'll have to see what kind of putt he has coming back. Schusterick, after hitting a tree, his third shot.
Yeah, you can see the small window that he had being on the left side of that fairway, but he was able to squeak it just over that bush and possibly for a putt.
And this is the result of Ricky's big hyzer over the road. Yeah, must have caught something coming back in. He had to straddle a lot of forehands so far. This course really challenges both your backhand and your forehand aspects of your game.
Yeah, it's a very fair course, you know, to either left-handed, right-handed, sidearm, backhand. Either way, it's fair, and it's the reason it's, you know, my favorite course in the world.
And KJ and Paul wearing the same jacket, getting the same score. That's a birdie three on the par four, hole three. Moving on to hole four. Hole four is a downhill, 328 feet, right at 100 meters, and it's a 26-foot elevation change. And being tight and technical and playing downhill, you know, what's the biggest thing you're trying to do here?
There's a cement pipe down there. You'll probably see it here in a second, but I try to get my drive to land right there. It's just inside the circle, but unfortunately, all four rounds, I never had one close to the circle. I don't know why, but this hole had my number, and you can see KJ just puts it right under flies it right under the basket. Unfortunately, with that downhill green, slipped pretty far past.
And this is the hole that Philo Brathwaite did ace in an earlier round. Unfortunately, we weren't able to capture that one on camera, but you know, you can see that it's a high risk reward style shot. When you're throwing downhill like that, you need to get it to slow down, but you also have to give it enough energy to get there.
Yeah, my caddy right here, Jonas, told me to lay that one up because he saw what I did yesterday trying to run that putt.
And it's really great to have a caddy that knows your game. It's a rare thing at this point in the sport's evolution. But, you know, how much do you think that that's going to factor into, you know, decision making and things like that going into the future?
I think it's going to be, you know, big for the sport and the players because, I mean, being only 14 years old, Jonas knew so much about disc golf. And there's a good putt for bird by Rick. But, I mean, he knew so much about my game and the course that he definitely helped me out a lot and, you know, actually made some of my decisions for me, which, you know, it kind of helps when you don't have to think on every hole and every shot. So I think it'll be a key in the future.
And you'll see a little more of that, what Paul's hinting at, and on the back nine. So stay tuned for that video later on. Move on to hole five. Like you said, Ricky is the only birdie. Everybody else is going to take a par. And hole five is another very reachable hole, 308 feet, 23 feet of uphill elevation change. So play down the hill, play right back up the hill. That's a very interesting course design trick. You know, you have to worry about the stability of your disc throwing downhill and then turn around and do the opposite coming back up. Do you think those subtle things, you know, play into the minds of people who aren't prepared for it, and does that affect the score?
Yeah, it definitely changes, you know, the shot selections and, you know, how we're throwing because it's so much different to throw downhill than uphill. And to have these holes back-to-back like this, it's tough. This hole is so much more, you know, it's tighter than the hole before, and it is uphill, so you have to throw it a little bit harder. And with those trees right there, it definitely makes for some bad kicks if you catch any of them. But I think this is one of the more difficult par threes on the course.
I really like this hole because it's subtly difficult. It, you know, from the tee, it, you know, it's straight ahead, 308 feet, you're thinking, oh, I have to just base this and get it there. But if you didn't throw that perfect downhill shot on the hole before, you may overthink it and you may make the wrong disc selection, which will ultimately cost you a lot of strokes in trying to recover. And anyway, you're going to make a great putt there for birdie two. And KJ is just precise as ever. We talked about his precision on the Insider Show, and his preparation and his ability just to pinpoint the line that he's trying to throw was really impressive all weekend.
Yeah, three twos on that hole is pretty impressive for a group.
Great showing by the lead card there. Now hole six. Hole six is one of my favorite holes. The longest hole down in the Arboretum. It measures 551 feet. It is a par four. Slightly uphill. It measures 11.5 feet of elevation change uphill. And tell me about the spot you're trying to play to here.
Pretty much right there where Ricky ended up. Either in that line, you could be about 20 feet short of that, or you can be as far as 60 feet further than that. That's probably the most ideal spot because it shapes, the trees shape the fairway down to the basket. And I turned mine over right there. And that's a spot I've never been on this hole. It was to the right. Usually I end up high left and just like that, like KJ's. Those are the money spots right there, and you want to get up and down and take your birdie.
If you don't get to that corner, it can be just a little more difficult of an ante, and you'll see when we get to this green, it's a tricky green, so that the less you're able to get to that sweet spot, the more of a very tough upshot you're going to have trying to bend that anhyzer around the corner and get it to land flat.
Yeah, I believe this is the toughest green because of that drop-off just to the right of the basket, and it drops off pretty quickly, probably about 18 feet with, you know, straight down. And
KJ's shot looks like he got slowed down by a tree a little bit, but he's not unhappy about it. Ricky's going to opt for the forehand, and he's pumped up early. He's looking for blood.
Yeah, he came out swinging early and, you know, put that one right under the basket. So there's another birdie for Rick, and he's making strokes, and that shot right there was just too high. I didn't get it turned enough, and it still kicked a little bit towards the basket, but it's not where I want it. And great upshot right there by Will, put him, you know, 15 feet from the basket.
And looking at almost a death putt, got a little lucky there. You hit the front side of the band sitting so you can get the par, and these guys should easily be able to grab a birdie, and the whole card gets a stroke on you. And are you thinking about that? How does that make you feel when you see that happen?
I was more disappointed in myself for not three in this hole, especially with how fortunate I was off that drive to actually have an upshot. So I was more frustrated at myself than them gaining a stroke on me at that point.
moving on to hole 7. Big uphill, 289 feet, and you're throwing to a mound green where the slope right by the basket is really tough, so you have to watch how your disc comes in and hits the ground. We talk about that at so many tournaments, a trick that tournament directors and course designers use to make you really have to control the speed of your disc coming into the green, or you're going to catch a roll away and not have a birdie putt on a hole that you really need to get on the front nine.
Yeah, this hole, I mean, you have a slightly small gap to hit off the, you know, right off the tee pad, but then it is on a mound, so your main goal is to just throw it into that hill. And with Will right here, you can see his shot. He hits that line perfect, but unfortunately, it's really hard to get it above that hill. And you can see he just soars right over it because you are playing it into the hill. And when you do make that mistake, it kind of puts a damper on that line that you hit.
So inevitably, no matter what you do, you're going to be throwing a uphill putt, which obviously with the slope on the backside can make it very difficult. And if you miss that putt, or, you know, God forbid you airball it, then you have to worry about not only saving your par, but also possibly saving your bogey on the comebacker.
Yeah, and then on this left side of the green, there are a lot of trees in the way, and that's a putt I should have made right there, but I was too frustrated about the roll away that my drive had, and it got to me. It's not a bogey, so I can't be too mad.
Will Schusterick will clean up his par, and so will you, Paul. And it looks like a couple birdies for KJ and for Ricky. Moving on to hole 8. Hole 8 is very tough. Par 5, the longest hole on the course, 863 feet. 6 feet of elevation change, pretty minimal. But you really, with the way they place the tee, you've got to get past these first couple guardian trees that are about, you know, 33 meters off the pin.
Yeah,
off the tee.
This hole probably has the most, you know, routes you can take off the tee. You can throw a sidearm wide, a turnover wide, or you can throw through the middle gap with a turnover or sidearm, and then there's even some people throwing short little hyzers and flex forehands. And it's really interesting to see which route these players take, and I think all four of us ended up taking a different route.
And with the way that they mow the fairways and leave the rough a little bit longer, not only do you have to be careful as a right-handed player, you have to bend it just at the right angle, because if you get that cut roll, you're not going to get that circle back into the fairway. When it hits that taller grass in the rough, it's going to stay there.
Yeah, Ricky hit the first tree on the drive and then hits another tree, you know, not too far down the fairway, and was fortunate enough to stay in bounds right there.
Looks like it hit a spectator, got a little kick, and a very fortunate result for Ricky. Will Schusterick lining up the backhand. Schusterick and Wysocki hitting a couple trees off of this fairway.
Yeah, I believe actually all three of them hit the same tree. KJ just happened to hit the branch on the tree and didn't square it up like the other two. You can see his disc right there, half in, half out.
Half in is all in. He won't take the stroke. Line up a big forehand, and this green is difficult to film and difficult to approach. Kind of describe this green.
The basket's up on a mound, and OB's inside the circle right behind it. So it's tough to put it close to the basket from you know, a far distance. But I mean, the main goal on your second or third shot right there for Will and I is really just skip it close to that fence, get on the left side of the fairway, so there is nothing in your way. Because if you are on the right side of the fairway, you have some more trees to deal with, some bushes and low branches, so it still makes for a difficult upshot. And from where I am to, you know, 30 feet left of that is pretty much where you want to be laying up for a birdie right there.
So between the way, it almost looks like a miniature levee, and then that ground comes up and the trees come down, so you have a smaller window to hit, and then it drops out below the basket. So again, you're talking about that uphill both ways kind of putt. And Will Schusterick, this, I qualify that as a death putt, because, you know, bad things can happen. We got to see his roller and see if he was out of bounds here.
Yeah, he rolled out, went off the basket, rolled out of bounds. But I mean, to even have an opportunity to save a birdie essentially, was it two huge shots? or a huge shot and a, you know, a big putt that would have had to happen, and unfortunately it rolled away out of bounds.
We're talking about how difficult this hole is. You made it look very easy. Not much more than a, you know, 8-10 foot birdie putt for you, Paul. Ricky and Will will take bogeys on that. KJ will take a par, which is ultimately okay. A lot of very big numbers have come on that hole. A lot of front nines and charges that people have been making have been stymied on that hole. And then we did a hole nine, a hole you're very familiar with. I'm going to let you take it away and tell me about this.
This hole has two routes. You know, you got the sidearm or turnover route, or you can go down the middle, which I believe I only saw KJ go for up until this point when he switched to a sidearm. But this was probably my best hole of the tournament. The first round, I was able to skip one in for an ace, and then after that, my sidearm was within 20 feet the other three rounds. It shaped so well for my forehand and just the right distance and disc. And I don't know if that was Ricky or Will, but it was Ricky. But they, you know, you can see that forehand's in their game, and it was no problem for them as well.
And sometimes the holes are just tailor-made for a shot that you're really good at. Obviously, like you're saying, carding a one in the first round that would get you off to a very fast start and a record-setting round here at the Beast. And this hole is about just, you know, have an accurate shot and make your putt. One of my favorite things about this hole is from the tee, it looks a lot more closed off than it is. The gap is actually there, but when you're looking at it, you've got to trust the practice routine that you've done and the preparation that you have, because it doesn't look like the gap is as big as it actually is.
Yeah, like you said, you can't really see how open it is from the tee pad. You just have to, you know that you practice it and throw that shot. And then this green is probably the windiest of all the greens because of that soccer field just pulling the wind through there, and you can see that flag blowing, and those 20-footers are not too easy.
And KJ will take a par on that hole, and three other birdies for Will, Ricky, and Paul. And that's already through nine holes. You're approaching the TV. You're trying to capitalize on the lead, trying to keep the back end in play and just make it through this round. Thanks for joining us, and we're going to stay right here. We're actually going to go ahead and roll on into the back nine. Check our next video. We're going to see the big drama that's going to happen. Inevitably, you know, with these guys on that card, that it's going to come down to a great finish, and I guarantee you we have one. On SpinTV, check out the back nine of the 2015 European Open. I'm Jamie Thomas. He's Paul McBeth. We'll see you right back.